Good morning, everybody. So after this brief wait, I think we are communicating. So I would like to ask dear students, when did you learn this definition of physics? Was it taught to you in say secondary school or at the plus two level? And if so, what was the definition? Do you remember that definition still? In fact, I can't. I have learned that definition in my school days, and it was like many other definitions, very tedious. And at that time, I really failed to understand that. And in fact, after learning physics for several years also, we ponder while facing this question as to what is the definition of physics. Now this answer to this question, it contains in history and evolution of physics. After learning, you know, the classical physics, then the quantum mechanics, relativistic physics, at undergraduate level, we still struggle to describe what is the exact difference between say classical physics, the quantum physics, and the relativistic physics. So let us try to ponder over some of these issues and get the concepts clear. Now, definition as such is just one line, you know. In a formal manner, physics is defined as science of measurement. So simple one line answer. What is physics? Physics is science of measurement. But for this, we have to define what is science. And then we have to explain what we mean by measurement. So science is defined as understanding universe around us in terms of cause and effect. I will explain later why science is defined in this particular way. So we know there is nothing like magic. If we see some effect, there is a cause behind it. And a definite cause will always produce definite effect. This is also known as principle of causality, which is very, very fundamental to all sciences. Now, this science, it consists of several steps. First step is the objective description. By that we mean, whatever phenomena we are describing, it does not depend on who is describing, whether it is described, whether a law of physics is described at Karaikal or whether it is described here in Nagpur. It is the same. It is universal. Then after the description, we try to establish a logical sequence as to what is the cause and what is the effect. Once such a sequence is established, which we often call as law, even in chemistry or in physics, we say this is the law of physics, the famous three laws of Newton that describes mechanics. And then even in electricity and magnetism, you have learned Lenz's law and so on and so forth. So once we have established such a law, then we can predict that if such and such cause is there, what will be the effect? We can predict that. Or if we observe the effect, from that we know what must have caused that effect. And then this prediction also, if we have not observed effect, then we can verify experimentally. We can create or simulate in the laboratory a cause and then observe the effect. Now, if our understanding is correct, then we can verify. And if in verification, during verification, if we get a result which is not as per prediction, then our understanding is not complete. Then we go back again to the objective description as to where we have made a mistake. So we again inspect the description and go through this loop. So in this sense, science is evolving. Science changes, you know, changes in the sense our understanding develops. Our understanding is never complete. It is continuously increasing. That is the beauty of science. Now, was science like that which we have defined just now? Did it exist in the same form? The answer is no. Not so long ago, it was not that. We are in a very fortunate era, but some 2-3 centuries back, science had to face a lot of hardship. Science was dominated by religious leaders with backing of the rulers. You know, 2-3 centuries back, there was democracy nowhere. There was military rule. This world was ruled by military. And then combination of religion and whatever technology existed at that time, it helped the rulers to maintain social order. So in this form of science, it was told that this universe, it is created by God, and only religious leaders, they have understood it. You have not understood it. But whatever religious leaders say, you must believe it. So science in that area was an article of faith. You couldn't question it. So if you are questioning science in that area, in that era, then it was like disobeying God. And if you defy God, then the effects will be very, very bad, and a whole earth will be destroyed. So it was the fear of God induced in people, which made them obey the ruler, king, and the religious leaders. So in those days, the science was based more on hypothesis. All these hypotheses, these were untested, and it was based on speculations rather than experimentation. There was no verification. Now we find many such hypotheses which are recorded, you know, in history of science. These appear very ridiculous now. It makes you laugh. Just to name few, you know, the hypothesis of stationary earth, you know that, right? That it was said that earth is stationary. What was the reason for that? Only logic offered was that man is most important creation of God. Man stays on earth. So the most important place in universe is earth. So earth will not move. Everything else will move around the earth. That was the hypothesis. Similarly, how do the life forms, how are birds and fish and insects coming? Then ideas were given that if there is a tree on the bank of a river or on the beach of a lake, then when the leaves fall in the water, then fish are created. If the leaves go in air, then birds are created. And then insects are created from rotten flesh. So this was the idea, and you were not supposed to question these ideas. Similarly, element aurium, you know, for gold, the symbol is Au. Why Au? Au stands for aurium. So looking at the sun in the morning, you know, it looks reddish, and as it comes above the horizon, it appears rather golden. So there was a hypothesis that there is a lot of gold at the center of sun. So these are sort of hypotheses which were created, which were written in religious books, and you were not supposed to speak any word against it. So true scientists who did not agree with this, then they often were sentenced to death. You might be knowing Copernicus, right? I mean, who said that the earth is revolving around the sun? Then he was prosecuted, and you know the history. That's why modern science, you know, the science we are learning today, it evolved from the sufferings of true scientists, brought out the black side of the pseudoscience. So modern science is designed to remove this lacuna, that science should be objective, not subjective. I go by the laws of physics, not because my teacher is telling me or some leader is telling me, nothing like that, but I can verify it in my laboratory and be satisfied. And that's how I say, yes, these are the laws of physics. Hence, the science has got a very sort of solid structure, which is objective description, establishing cause and effect sequence, then prediction, and then verification. So this is the science. Now, physics being a science of measurement, so every cause and every effect is quantified. It is not qualitative, but it is quantified. Means every cause has got units. You know, as a student of physics, you must have been troubled by these units. You try to solve a numerical problem and you get the answer wrong. Then you discover, yes, I have not used proper units. So every quantity in physics has got definite units and it has got definite measure. So various laws of physics can thus be written with help of an equation. You know the famous Newton's second law, F is equal to ma, that the force applied equals mass into acceleration. However, we must remember that equation is there to help us for remembering law of physics. Equation itself is not a law. Why I'm saying that? Because equation has got left hand side and right hand side and we know equality. But equation does not tell what is cause and what is effect. Equation might tell you, in fact, say E equal to AR, that is voltage is equal to resistance multiplied by current. But what is the effect? Is voltage the effect or is resistance the effect or current is the effect? And what is the cause? For that, we have to understand physics. We know that voltage is the cause. If you have got constant voltage source, then voltage is the cause and the resistance, the current is the effect. And how much current, that will be decided by resistance in the circuit. So what is cause and effect, that is not told by the equation, but for that we have to know the statement of the law. Now, objectivity demands that the laws of physics must be universal. They will not depend on space, they will not depend on the time. So Ohm's law is same at Karaikal, it is same in Nagpur, it is same in every corner of the world. Now, this is because we want science to be objective. It is not proved that laws of physics are same. So from fundamental principle, it is not proved. But if physics or the science has to be objective, then laws must be true everywhere. At all times, everywhere in the universe, the law must hold. That is the true form of a law of physics. Now, classical physics is thus described in terms of universe, and the universe is understood in terms of cause and effect, which are measurable, right? They are quantitative because physics is science of measurement. So everything is measurable. So this is what we call as the principle of causality and principle of determinism, that a definite cause will lead to definite effect, and without cause there will be no effect. In fact, Newton's law of motion, this is manifestation of principle of causality and determinism. What is the statement of Newton's law of motion? That every body continues its straight line motion unless acted upon by external force, right? So uniform motion continues. So if there is no force, there is no acceleration. And how much is the acceleration? Ratio of force to acceleration is constant and is called as the mass of the body. So this description is based on some fundamental assumptions like absolute time and absolute space. It means these definitions, these laws, they are valid at all times and are everywhere in the universe. In mathematical terms, this classical physics is Galilean invariant. What we mean by that? That the laws of physics, they do not depend on where you are measuring the quantities, how you are measuring the quantities, when you are measuring the quantities, but laws of physics are valid. So in the classical physics, the universe is also divided into matter and radiation. Matter means something consisting of particles, right? Matter, that it cannot be destroyed. Matter cannot be created. It is the conservation, right? There are many conservation laws which are very sacred to classical physics and even in quantum mechanics, that matter cannot be created or destroyed. What is radiation? Radiation is sort of wave. So wave can be created, wave can be attenuated, wave can be stopped completely. But the particle, you can stop motion of a particle, but you cannot destroy a particle. So in the classical physics, matter and radiation, so everything in universe will be described either as a matter or as a radiation. If it is radiation, it is not matter. And if it is matter, it is not radiation. So the descriptions are mutually exclusive. So we see that particle and wave descriptions become mutually exclusive. A particle is not a wave, and a wave is not a particle. Waves, you know, wave can interfere. So two waves can interfere destructively and resultant will be zero. But two particles cannot come together and destroy each other. This is the big difference, you know. So all these characteristics, which we have seen briefly, these are implicit part of definition of physics. And this physics we call as classical physics. Now, why the adjective classical physics? Because later on, some concepts had to be revised. So we will briefly see within this 1 hour as to how much basic concepts we can learn. There was new physics and it led to new definitions. So towards end of 19th century, scientists were sitting very pretty. They thought that, yes, now the era of that pseudoscience is gone. Now nobody will be hanged for speaking out truth. Nobody need believe a religious leader or a ruler as far as science is concerned. Everybody can verify whatever laws of physics he can verify in the laboratory, be satisfied, and then only accept the law as the correct law. So it was thought that all the fundamental principles of universe we have understood, and okay, some small modifications will be there. This will be some evaluating the constant up to say nth decimal place. That's all. Ironically, when scientists felt that they have understood everything, just in next 5 to 10 years, discoveries were made. And they challenged this science, they challenged the physics, they challenged the laws of physics, which were essentially based on Newtonian mechanics or Newtonian physics. And drastic revision of the basic concept was required in order to understand the new phenomena. Now, these concepts were changed, you know, over the years, and the changes, we can follow two paths. One is the relativistic physics, another is the quantum physics. So we will try to understand what is relativistic physics and what it is not, what is quantum physics and what it is not, because there are, I think perhaps this relativistic physics and quantum physics, it is introduced at very premature level, so many times wrong ideas are formed. So it is equally important to know what is quantum mechanics and to know what it is not. That is also equally important to get out the wrong notions. So we will see this new physics, relativistic mechanics and quantum mechanics. First, we will see what is the relativistic physics, the origin of relativity. So, you know, the classical physics, it starts with mechanics. Now, in mechanics, you know, is divided into statics and dynamics. So, whether an object is in motion, a body is in motion or not, how do we know? Then we observe position. So, if position of a body changes with time, then body is in motion. If position of an object is not changing with time, then that body is stationary. This is easy to understand. And then the motion we describe in terms of velocity, acceleration, and so on, right? So Newtonian three laws, you know. Now, when we say Newtonian law, you know, it also established that force is cause and acceleration is effect, not the velocity. So it took some 100 years to understand. Even now, many of you feel that what is the cause behind velocity? You feel that it is force. This is not correct. This is wrong. This wrong notion is formed because we see that unless you are forced to do something, you don't do it, right? So we feel that velocity comes out of force. This is not correct. What is the cause of velocity? Cause of velocity is momentum. So if a body is moving, then it is moving because of its momentum. And if you apply force, then momentum changes, and rate of change of momentum is proportional to the external applied force, and this rate of change of momentum is related to acceleration. So acceleration is the effect, force is the cause. But we know that this velocity depends on frame of reference, isn't it? Very familiar example. Even without learning physics, you know, when you, as a child, when you traveled, then you must have experienced that trees are moving in opposite direction, isn't it? So you imagine that you are stationary and it is the trees which are moving. So we know in your frame of reference, your velocity is zero and trees are moving. Whereas in a frame of reference connected to the ground, the trees are stationary and you are moving. So we see that when we say position, then we must define a frame of reference. From origin, we measure x coordinate, y coordinate, z coordinate. So this is how, I mean, we come to the frame of reference, isn't it? So the position itself is not defined unless we have got a frame of reference. But does it mean that whatever law of physics we define, or let us say laws of motion, they are valid only in the frame of reference in which we have measured position? Then the laws will not be objective, laws will not be universe, and whatever science we have built up, it will fall down. So again, we'll go back to the chaotic situation, isn't it? This should not happen. Fortunately, we just have to modify the statement of the Newtonian law, and then we see that yes, laws of physics are universal, they are valid in all frames of reference. So we say it is possible to find out a frame of reference with respect to which a body which is not subjected to external force continues its straight line uniform motion. So once this modification is done, then we find that all Newtonian, they are same in all frames of reference. Now, this is for mechanics, but if you come to electrostatics, yes, again, language is same. What is electrostatics? How do we define? What is electrostatic force? F is equal to Q1, Q2 upon R square. and proportional to q1 q2 upon r square. We define electrostatic potential, which is similar to gravitational potential. Electrostatic potential is work done in bringing a unit positive charge from infinity to that point. So language is that of mechanics. In magnetism, what is the magnetic potential? Work done in bringing unit north pole from infinity to that point. So entire physics, you know, is in language of mechanics. So when we prove laws of mechanics to be universal, then we have proved all laws of physics to be universal. They do not depend on space. They do not depend on time. Space and time are assumed to be absolute because space does not depend on measurement. Time does not depend on measurement. Now, this is also called as Galilean principle of relativity. That laws of physics assume same form in all frames of reference. Such frames were called as inertial frames, obviously for the frame of reference in which law of inertia is valid. Such frame is called as inertial frame. And if law of inertia is valid, all laws of mechanics, all laws of physics, classical physics, they are valid in this frame of reference. In mathematical form, we say laws of physics are invariant under Galilean transformation equations. What are transformation equations? We know if we change a frame of reference, then position will change. So the position is given as x star equal to x minus vt, where v is the velocity of the starred frame of reference with respect to unstarred frame of reference. And time doesn't change. Time is same in whatever frame of reference you measure. So the logic given for that was, whether you measure time or not, time flows, isn't it? So if you are finding my lecture to be boring, even if you look in your watch, the time will not run faster, time will not run slower, but time will go by its own speed. And I will stop at the end of 1 hour, isn't it? So time does not depend on measurement. Time is absolute. That is the concept of basic physics. Similarly, the length of an object, it doesn't depend who is measuring, right? Your height, if it is say 172 centimeter, it is going to be 172 centimeter. It does not depend who is measuring your height. So length of the object, it is absolute property of that object. It doesn't depend on the measurement. Time does not depend on who is measuring it. So absolute space and absolute time, these are the concepts, you know, of the classical physics, or we can say the Galilean or Newtonian physics is based on absolute space and absolute time. So it also says addition of velocity. So if A is moving with respect to B by velocity u, and B is moving with respect to C with velocity w, then the relative velocity of u with respect to w is simply u plus v. So this is the Galilean law for the transformation. So u is equal to u star plus v. It is simply law of addition of velocity. This we know, that you must have experienced, that if both you and your friend, you are in motion, right? You are riding a bicycle. But if you are riding with equal speed, then you are stationary with respect to each other, and you can have your communication, your going on uninterrupted. So you can converse with your friend if you are moving with same velocity. This is the common experience. Now, what about law of propagation of light? When light was established as the electromagnetic wave, then you know the Maxwellian equations, they predicted velocity of light. It depends on the permeability and the permittivity of the medium. So it was calculated that in vacuum or in free space, velocity of light will have value c, that is 3 into 10 raised to 8 meters per second. and it is same in all directions. Now, the moment we say velocity, with respect to which frame of reference, isn't it? Because in other frame of reference, velocity will be different. If it is C in frame S, then in frame of reference C, S star, it will be C minus V. And then people started to measure this velocity of light in a different frame of reference. But it was found, there were so many experiments, you know, there was stellar aberration, Hughes experiments, and Michelson-Morley experiment, very, very famous experiment. All these experiments were performed to detect change of velocity of light when you change frame of reference. And it was found that even if you change frame of reference, there is no change in velocity of light. It means velocity of light is absolute. Now, this is against the Galilean principle of relativity, isn't it? So, it was then accepted that principle of relativity fails. Principle of relativity is not applicable to phenomena of propagation of light. So, principle of relativity was abandoned. Then Einstein rose to the scene. So, Einstein, in fact, stated that no, principle of relativity is correct, and we cannot have, say, different frames of reference. Laws of physics cannot depend on frame of reference. But there is some mistake in our understanding, and this mistake is in the concept of absolute space and absolute time. The Galilean principle relativity was based on the equation T star equal to T, absolute time, L star equal to L. So we have now two options. We assume L star is equal to L, T star is equal to T. But then velocity of light should not be same. This is the Newtonian physics. Another option is that velocity of light is same in all frames of reference. But time is not absolute and space is not absolute. All experimental results show that velocity of light is same in all inertial frames of reference. So our concept that space is absolute, time is absolute, this concept is wrong. Time is also relative, length is also relative. This is the Einstein's theory of relativity. Or in terms of mathematics, you can say the old principle of relativity was laws of physics are invariant under Galilean transformation. The Einstein's principle of relativity is laws of physics are invariant under the Lorentz transformation equation. Now, whatever physics we have learned, classical physics, it is only approximate form, and the correct form is that in which the laws of physics will be invariant under Lorentz transformation. This gave rise to lot of new ideas, so that we have to change. If the momentum is conserved, you know, the conservation of momentum, conservation of energy, then we must change the definition of momentum and the definition of energy. You have learned two forms of energy, right? Kinetic energy and potential energy. What is kinetic energy? Energy which a body possesses by virtue of its motion. What is potential energy? Energy which a body possesses by virtue of its position. What is law of conservation of energy? Energy cannot be created or destroyed, but it can change from one form to the other. So if these laws are to be valid, then we have to redefine energy, we have to redefine momentum. In this sense, then mass is not constant, but mass of a object is given by m0 upon under root 1 minus v square by c square, where m0 is called as the mass when velocity is 0. So m0 is the mass of an object measured in its rest of frame of reference. in a frame of reference with respect to which object is stationary. In any other frame, the mass will be more. From this, we know there is third form of energy, which is called as rest energy. And there is equivalence between energy and mass. E is equal to m0 c square. So the law of, say, conservation of mass is not correct. Mass can be destroyed. Mass can be destroyed and converted into energy. Mass is equivalent to energy. And energy can be destroyed and converted into mass. So energy plus mass together will be conserved. Now this concept has explained, you know, the universe, creation of stars, how Earth is created, how we are getting sun from the energy, or rather energy from the sun, how sun is radiating so much energy. Then the nuclear energy, and so on and so forth. So this concept is so important. It explains so many facts, and it also predicts. It predicted atomic bomb. So if you split an atom, then some mass is destroyed. This mass, destroyed mass, gives you energy. That is energy of a nuclear fission. And you know, we have nuclear reactors. We can generate electricity from uranium and so on and so forth. It also explains the inverse, that if you fuse two nuclei and in that process some mass is destroyed, then again you get back the energy. So this is the principle of the hydrogen bomb or the fusion bomb. So the most of the energy we are observing, this comes from fusion. So the lighter elements fuse together producing heavier elements, energy is destroyed in that. So this is how in brief we saw the origin of the relativistic mechanics. Now we come to the third branch. So repeat what we have seen. We have seen that the classical physics is the physics which is invariant under Galilean transformation law. It is based on absolute space, absolute time. Relativistic physics is invariant under Lorentz transformation. In this case, the velocity of light in free space is same, but length of an object and the time, they depend on measurement of frame of reference. And then the mass and energy, there is equivalence. Mass can be destroyed to create energy, and energy can be destroyed to create mass. So these are basic differences, you know. And there are many more eventually which will come, but these are very fundamental. Now we come to the quantum mechanics. Now, you know, classical physics failed to explain black body radiation. These are some of the phenomena: structure of atom and atomic spectra, photoelectric effect, electron diffraction, and so on. In short, classical physics has assumed that if there something is particle, it cannot be a wave. If something is wave, it cannot be particle. A particle cannot be created or destroyed. Wave can be created or destroyed. You know the phenomena of interference, right? Then even the structure of atom, you know what is atom? Then through Rutherford experiment, we know that it is nucleus, and nucleus is positively charged. But overall atom is neutral. So there must be some negative charge also if nucleus is positive. And this negative charge was called an electron. But if positive and negative charges are together, they will annihilate each other. So how come this electron is not falling into nucleus? Then we said there is some centripetal force and so on and so forth. So electrons are not stationary, but they are moving in orbit. But if they are moving in orbit, they must radiate energy. If they radiate energy continuously, they will lose energy, and ultimately electron should fall into nucleus. But this doesn't happen. Similarly, the photoelectric effect, you must have learned that photoelectric effect. What is that effect? That if waves, light waves fall on a matter, then electron is ejected out. Electron is a particle. So how can light give momentum to the particle? And why there is a threshold wavelength? The energy of a light, it is proportional to amplitude square. Frequency or wavelength doesn't enter into it. It depends only on amplitude. So I increase the amplitude, then light wave energy which should be sufficient to knock out an electron. But this doesn't happen. On the other hand, if you assume that light is a particle, then we know. So a particle can exchange momentum instantaneously, and it must have sufficient momentum to start with. And Einstein gave the equation, borrowed the equation which was given by Max Planck. He said that energy of a radiation is not given by only amplitude square, but E is equal to h nu, where h is the Planck's constant and nu is the frequency. Later on, electron diffraction was also found out. Electron is a particle, then it cannot diffract, because diffraction is a wave, interference is a wave, particles cannot. Particle have got definite position, so it cannot produce a wave pattern, but wave pattern was formed. So obviously, what we have described in classical physics, mutually exclusive description of particle and wave, this description is wrong. In classical physics, we say if something is particle, it is not wave, and if it is wave, it cannot be particle. This description is wrong. We must modify the description of physics such that the description will be not mutually exclusive, but it will be dual. A same entity, a system can be described also as a wave, and system cannot be described also as a particle. How this can be done? So this can be done. This was shown by Charles de Broglie, that momentum is a particle property and wavelength is a wave property. So he gave the bridge. A bridging equation was lambda is equal to h by p. P is the momentum, lambda is the wave. So on left hand side, we have wave-like properties. On the right hand side, we have particle-like properties. So wave-particle equivalence is shown through the equation given by Charles de Broglie. So before that, Bohr's theory and Planck's formula had suggested E equal to h nu, but there was no derivation of this relation. It was ad hoc that E is equal to h nu. In Bohr's theory, it was ad hoc theory that electron can move in certain stationary objects without radiating energy. How can it move in that orbit? No explanation. This is against the classical physics. But wave mechanics gave the equivalence and gave the explanation. And then there was a third type of mechanics. It was called as the operator mechanics. So it was very, very, mathematical, that you have certain mathematical quantities as opposed to classical physics. In classical physics, you have got force or physical quantities. They can be measured directly. They have got units. But in the operator mechanics, everything is explained simply by certain mathematical quantities. You have got mathematical equation, and the quantities in that equation have no physical meaning. After you carry out mathematical operations, you come across some number, and this number only can be associated with physical quantity. So this is the basic difference in quantum mechanics and the classical physics. Third type of mechanics was matrix mechanics, where quantities were represented by matrices. And then the modern quantum mechanics is in fact mixture of wave mechanics, operator mechanics, matrix mechanics. Equivalence of all these three methods was shown. In fact, all four methods you can say was shown. And this is what we mean by the quantum mechanics, that it includes wave mechanics, operator mechanics, matrix mechanics, and so on. Now, basically, what is the difference between quantum mechanics and the classical mechanics? In classical mechanics, when you describe a law of physics, then all the quantities are physically measurable. You can perform the experiment and you can measure those quantities. But in quantum mechanics, we describe the system by a wave function. So this wave function, this is not a physical observable. Wave function cannot be measured. Wave function is just some mathematical function. Nothing more, nothing. Now, when an operator operates on a wave function, then you get some result. So the information about the measurable quantity is obtained using the operator. So operator itself has no meaning. Wave function also has no meaning. But when operator operates on a wave function, if a real number is produced, then that real number has meaning. So, you know, the quantum mechanics is a bit abstract. It speaks in terms of wave function. It speaks in terms of operators, which themselves are not measurable. What is measurable is the result of the mathematical operation. And in general, this description is probabilistic. So, mod psi square is probability that a particle will be observed at that position. And then operator operating on that, that gives you the statistical mean of the measurement. So it is the statistically weighted average for that physical measurement. So if you have got, say, momentum operator, it operates on the wave function, what you get is the say statistically weighted average of the momentum and not the actual momentum. And further, the quantum mechanics, it says that there is a limit to the accuracy with which you can measure. Classical physics says any physical measurement can be done with infinite accuracy. There is no limit. Accuracy, the limit is because of our instruments of measurement. But in concept, there is no limit on this. Now, as per quantum mechanics, there is a limit to this measurement. And you know the Heisenberg's principle of relativity. So Einstein did not like this idea. He was very much rooted to the principle of relativity. He did not approve quantum mechanics. But remember, science is objective. It doesn't go whether Einstein likes or not. Einstein may not like it, but quantum mechanics can be proved by experiments. So Einstein has said the famous statement, he does not play dice. What it means is that God has created universe. It is running by definite laws of physics, so it will not depend on probability. But quantum mechanics is now proven form of physics, and it seems that yes, he does play dice. But there is a misconcept that in quantum mechanics, everything is probabilistic, nothing is definite. No, no, this is not correct. What is the limit? The limit is that is given by the principle of Heisenberg's principle of uncertainty. What it means, you might have learned this principle that delta x, delta p has to be greater than h cross. It means if you have got two observables which are canonical conjugate, then they cannot be measured simultaneously with 100% certainty. So they can be measured only within the limits. So we say that the quantum mechanics, it is as deterministic as permitted by the Heisenberg's principle. So we say, and why this happens? Because this is how universe exists. Because I cannot measure two conjugate variables simultaneously with 100% certainty. And that is why a physical system also has some properties of waves. It also has some properties of the matter. Hence, I mean, this is the difference between classical physics and classical, rather the quantum mechanics. In classical physics, there is no, say, uncertainty product is zero. Delta x, delta p is zero. And in quantum mechanics, delta x delta p is of the order of h cross. So this one equation tells you the difference between classical physics and the quantum mechanics. In classical physics, delta x delta p is zero. In quantum mechanics, delta x delta p is of the order of h cross. So I am aware, I mean, this could be slightly difficult to you. It is not possible to explain everything in just 1 hour. I mean, for me, it is not possible. There will be some literature, you know, available. But even if I am successful in arousing your curiosity as to what is classical physics, what is relativistic physics, what is quantum physics, what are the similarities between these three, and what are the differences between these three, then I think the purpose of this lecture will be served. Otherwise, okay, some of you could have enjoyed the sleep while this lecture was going on, but it is time to wake up now, because some more interesting things will be coming up. So thank you very much for patiently listening to me, and thank you, Anil, specifically for giving. If there are some questions, I could answer, provided, I mean, I'm audible to you, and your question becomes audible to me. Back to you, Anil. I have finished my presentation.
Sir, you're audible.
Sir, we will put our question in chat box.
Exactly. That is what I have suggested.
So what is the sixth dimension in Einstein theory?
I have not come across that. In fact, by dimension, what we mean is that the number of independent observables, right? So it's not only in theory of relativity that we are talking about the dimensions. The meaning of dimension in classical physics is number of linearly independent observables. Now, you know that if it is a system of n number of particles, then there can be 3n degrees of freedom, what you call as degree of freedom, that is the number of dimension. So let us not try to visualize dimension, that two dimension means plane, three dimension is solid, then what is six dimension? Is it some subhuman or superhuman type of thing? It is not like that. The meaning of dimension in physics is number of linearly independent observables, or in simple words, you can say degrees of freedom of a system. I am sure you are familiar with the term degrees of freedom. Right, the use of operator mechanics and metric mechanics, these are sort of mathematical means. You know, if we want to have wave particle dualism, then what we are doing, we are describing a system function. But wave function itself is not a physical observable. So how can we compare our theory with experiments? So what we do is that we carry out either matrix operation or the operator operation. When this operator or matrix acts on a wave function, then we come across a real number. This real number can be compared with experimental result, and then we can say whether our theory is right or wrong. Well, the physics is totally, I mean, verifiable science, isn't it? So it is objective. If I say certain law of physics, then you should be able to verify it. And if I say that this is the wave function, if it has no meaning, can you verify that? You cannot verify. So what I do some mathematical operation. For example, in terms of integration also, I calculate psi star x psi d tau. That gives me certain answer. So that will be the position of the particle. You can experimentally then measure whether particle has got that position or not. If the predicted position and measured position agrees, then my theory is correct. So the operator mechanics, metric mechanics, this helps me in establishing the rather abstract wave function I can associate with the real world. In terms of mathematics, it helps me in obtaining a real number which can be compared with the experimental result. That's all. I think Anil will have to type.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So I may sound like a very dumb student, you know, because I'm taking long time to answer your question, but I have to read the question as Anil types it.
Sir, I have one doubt in a chat box.
What is he is quantum mechanics. I am not
sure. H-E, they are saying, student.
He is God, you know. In whenever we speak of God, you know, then he does not means God does not play dice. That is the famous statement of Einstein. You know, he didn't approve the idea of quantum mechanics, because in quantum mechanics we are talking in terms of probability. And what Einstein said, that God has created universe. He has created universe. He means God. And then universe is ruled by his rules, right? God has made the rules. So these are definite rules. It does not depend on probability, right? It is something definite. So why should we describe in terms of probability as in quantum mechanics? So he does not play dice means God does not play dice. That is the meaning, you know. But as I told you, that he does play dice. If quantum mechanics is verified by experimental theories, and it says that universe is described in terms of probability. So a same entity you can describe also as a particle, also as a wave. So when two measurable quantities are canonically conjugate, we have to speak in terms of probability. You cannot measure it with 100% certainty. Well, there have been lots of speculations about the particle traveling with speed greater than velocity of light, right? And these are called as tachyons. But these are still imaginary particles. It is said that this particle cannot be brought to rest in any frame of reference. That is the meaning of that, because the mass will become imaginary, isn't it? You know, mass is m is equal to m0 upon under root 1 minus v square by c square. So if v is greater than c, then the mass becomes imaginary. So it is said that that particle with imaginary mass, the meaning is that this particle cannot be brought to rest in any frame of reference. That's why its rest mass is imaginary. But still, this is simply, you know, only a mathematical type of hypothetical question. Oh yes, the simple equation that connects classical and next question, equation connecting classical and quantum mechanics. As I told you, it is even the Bohr's correspondence principle, right? So in the limit, when the uncertainty cannot be measured experimentally, then you say that classical and quantum result will be one and the same thing. If you try to calculate, say, wavelength of a car or scooter, then this wavelength may come out to be by lambda equal to h by p. We know momentum of a scooter. Then this wavelength may come out to be 10 raised to minus 50 meters or something. Now, compared to dimension of a scooter, this difference of 10 raised to minus 50 meters is not measurable. It is not relevant. So in that case, you know, the classical and quantum laws will become similar. So the uncertainty relation delta x delta p is equal to 0, delta x delta p is equal to h cross. This is difference between classical and quantum. So your experimental measurements, are they relevant within the accuracy of h cross, Planck's constant? That will decide. Similarly, in case of theory of relativity also, that if v by c is very, very small, then the relativistic quantities will become almost same as the classical quantities. So it is the ratio of v by c, whether it is relevant, whether it is measurable with your experimental setup. Then if it is not so, then the relativistic and the classical results will be same. So you can say the classical physics is same as relativistic physics in the limit v by c tending to 0. Similarly, the classical physics will be same as the quantum mechanics if uncertainty tends to 0, or the h cross is not then measurable within your setup.